Hello everybody, we are here for the second time with this Instagram live, and we have a very very special guest also this week. He's Robert Kubica. Wait a second, here it is. He is Robert. Hello.
Hello Mario.
Ciao Robert, how are you?
Good.
Oh, good.
We have to do that. Wait, I need to check my
check the position.
Yeah.
Okay. Yes. I have a box of tea to keep the telephone in the right position. So,
all right.
Technology. Good. Yeah. So, thank you for joining me in this Instagram live. I'm
my
sure
pleasure.
We will have a lot of questions coming from your fans. You have a
very
special group of fans from Poland, but
also from Italy. But you know, it's a first time we speak English, and it's strange.
It's true.
We never spoke between us in English.
It's true because you speak Italian very well, and I don't speak Polish at all. So we have to speak English. We are obliged by your fans because they wrote to me, but is it in Italian? No, we cannot join you. I said, no. We speak English.
Pirelli is an international company worldwide, so we speak English.
Okay, so what I want to know from you, a little bit more of everything, but I'm sure that we will have also questions coming from your fans. First of all, everybody knows about your career. Everybody knows about your passion for rallying and Formula One. So I know that you answered this question many, many times, but I believe it can be nice to start, because actually we met the first time when you were in WRC. So I had the opportunity to meet you.
I remember when we met first time. When we met first time?
WRC? You remember?
I met you earlier than 2013. We met once in the lobby of the hotel in 2010 in Udine. So.
Ah, really?
Yes.
Your memory is much better than mine.
You were already VIP 10 years ago, because I remember I was driving F1, but I was not VIP.
you were a lot more VIP than me. And we were in Udine for what? Rally Alpi Orientali.
Yes, exactly. I drove there. I think one of my not the first rallies, but I was like second, third rally.
Yeah.
And actually, I was using Pirelli tires.
That is good. That is good. So everybody knows your passion for rally. Which is your favorite rally?
Well, favorite rally. It's a difficult question because completely opposite to, let's say, circuits, you know, where the circuits, they look the same and more or less they are the same. It's just a question of different characteristic corners, high speed, low speed, bit of more chicane, bit of, different radius of the corners. Of course, we can split street circuits and permanent circuits, but more or less they are pretty all similar. You prefer one than the other, but it's not that they are completely different. And in rallying, it's completely opposite, especially in WRC, where you travel all around the world. Every country, every rally is completely different. And this is what is very special about WRC. And it's very difficult, especially for someone who is coming with limited experience. Because you gain experience 1 year, for example, Rally of Finland, which is a very unique, very fast, a lot of jumps over crest corners. You know, it's a special feeling driving there. But the experience you gain that year, you can only, let's say, see how much you improve year after, because there is no really a rally similar to Rally of Finland. And for example, same in Sardinia, which is a very nice rally. Same is about tarmac rallies. You know, Rally Deutschland is completely different to Monte Carlo or to Corsica. But my favorite, I have to say, would be, and not because I'm Polish, but I really enjoy the roads, it was Rally of Poland.
I was there a couple of times in Mikolajki's,
yeah,
correct?
Mikolajki, yeah,
Mikolajki.
but
Yeah.
yeah, it's a very, very unique because also it's very fast. It's similar to Finland as a speed, but it's completely different. The surface is much softer. You really can enjoy, and the difference between Finland and Poland is the roads are getting much worse because they are very soft. Between first and second pass, the conditions are changing a lot. But the speed you can go actually through those corners because they are very soft, soft roads. So you rely a lot on the tire, lie down on the car, you carry on massive speed. And yeah, because also it's Poland, you know, it's my
Yeah,
home.
it's your home country.
Yeah, exactly. You know, I'm doing motorsport since I was kid. First race I did in was 95. So it's already 25 years, but I never really had opportunity to race in front of my crowd in my home country. A part of karting in the beginning, but all the international series races, F1, I never race in front of Polish crowd on high level. So probably also that's why I really enjoy Poland, Rally of Poland.
Also, if a Polish crowd is following you everywhere in the world, because the only one that also at the testing, the official testing, has in the grandstand, a lot of fans is you. It's true, because a lot of time I see Polish fans that are following you everywhere. So it's incredible. And they are not
Yeah,
only Polish fans, as you said at the
no,
beginning.
I was joking. Yeah, for
No, it's
sure.
true.
You know, the fact is that the really amazing thing was when I did come back in Hungary in 2017 for the first official test after my accident, after more than 6 years away of the sport, there was probably 5,000 Polish fans for the testing, which is not normal. I mean, it's
Quite
unbelievable.
unusual,
Yeah,
quite unusual, yeah.
but still, there is always Polish flags. There is always some attention and support from Poland, which is nice. And it was the same in rallying. Actually, you know, I think many times I even unfortunately retire because of sometimes my accidents, sometimes because of failures. And everywhere on the stages, whether it was Sweden in the snow, whether it was mud in Wales, whatever it was, Mexico, I always find Polish people,
That's incredible.
which is probably the worst moment to find fans because you are upset because of accident or because of a failure. But it's unbelievable when you think about it. It's really good, and I really appreciate and would like to thank them.
Yes, it's great because it's the real motorsport flavor. The real motorsport is in these guys that are following you everywhere. Now, a lot of talking about rallying that is difficult to follow because people is not really willing to wake up very early in the morning, walk for hours to reach the special stages and all this kind of stuff. While on circuit is
Much
much more
easier,
co
yeah,
much easier,
comfortable.
much more comfortable.
I always say that the rally fans, the people who which you see on the rally stage are real fans. There
True.
is impossible that there is a person which walked probably for 5 kilometers standing there for maybe 1 hour because the roads are closed much earlier than we go through them, and it's impossible that there is, you know, a person which is for a mistake there, and this is
Yeah, exactly.
unbelievable. Sometimes, you know, in F1, sometimes you see people are there, but they are not interested about F1. They are more interested about to put an Insta story and
The
a selfie
glamour.
with the glamour and that's it, or have a champagne and you
True.
know, of course there are also many real fans, but it's a bit different. And I think rallying is a unique sport, and the DNA of rally fans is incredible. The passion is really incredible. Nothing, you know, against motorsport Formula One fans, circuit fans, which are also great, but though this, you know, DNA of rally fans is incredible, really.
No, it's true. It's true. It's nothing against the Formula One or any other motorsport activity. It's just a different
It's
approach.
just different, you know.
Yeah.
You can have you can like English pubs, or you don't like them, but they are very unique.
Or nice restaurants.
Yeah. So I think this is a bit kind of compare, but yeah, definitely. You know, if you imagine rally fans, you know, especially those ones which are moving between the stages during the day, you know, it's a kind of organization. You have to find the correct way, the fastest way, the shortest way to walk, the best place to watch, which is also very difficult. And then probably you see 15 cars, and then you disappear, you rush into the other stage, and maybe the stage is canceled. You know, I have many friends which walk maybe 6 kilometers, and the stage unfortunately was canceled. But it's kind of adventure, you know. I think when you see also families with kids, it's kind of adventure for them to go to see running.
Yeah, it's true. It's true. But coming back to your career, so you said you started with go kart.
Yes.
And you
95. 95 in karting. In karting, Poland.
You came to Italy also then after that?
I did 3 years in Poland when I was 10 years old, or 10, 11, 12. And then from age of 13, there is a junior category. There was a junior category, so called. And I started racing in Italy. The reason why Italy is because most of the, let's say, main races, they were in Italy and they are still. The most important manufacturers of chassis and engines are in Italy. Italy is a kind of center of the world for karting, and at that time it was the strongest championship in Europe or even in the world. Of course, there were European and world championship races, but let's say as a national races series, it was the toughest. And in fact, I was and I am the first one, not Italian, who won the Italian championship in the history.
I didn't know that.
Probably there were 60 years of karting, Italian karting championship. The first not Italian who won it, it was me. And I actually won it 98 and 99, 2 years in a row. So yeah, it has been a great time.
So it means that the leveling of karting in Italy is quite high, and is a sort of suggestion also for young guys that want to start their careers as a driver in Italy to come.
Well, now is a bit different. Still, of course, the teams and the let's say kart manufacturers are based in Italy. Most of them. There are some others. Italian championship dropped down a bit because there is a new championship which is very strong. It's WSK called. It's a kind of private championship, which I think is running since 2008, probably something like this, or maybe earlier. I don't remember exactly. And it's a very very important championship. All let's say main teams, main drivers are doing there. And national championship, national Italian championship, dropped down a bit. But still, Italy is, you know, when you go, especially testing, you come to Italy. You go Lonato, you know, near Milan, or Castelletto di Branduzzo, which I never have been there because it's a kind of quite modern track.
I was there.
What do you see?
It's a very nice track, yes.
Yeah, I have been there on, let's say, racetrack, car racetrack, a small car racetrack, but never driven in karting. For example, I was going to Parma, which was one of the best, San Pancrazio, which unfortunately is not existing anymore. But still, you coming to Italy to test, and you go Lonato in January, and maybe you have 50 karting drivers testing there, training there.
Yeah, true. I was talking to Daniel last week. I had the live Instagram with him, and he did the same, coming from Russia when he was a child, and that I was surprised when I spoke to him the first time that he was talking in Italian with a accent from Rome that is quite strange from a Russian guy. So I have some questions from your fans.
You have many. Some of them are Polish, in Polish or in
No. Luckily, they are in English. So okay. Starsky says, Robert, which battle in F1 is your personal favorite?
Which battle?
No, Not victory. We are talking about battle.
Yeah. For sure, the one which with Felipe in which I think everybody knows it, and it was quite popular lately in the internet from Fuji on wet. It was a hell of a battle on the for more than 5-6 corners, and in current days there will be a lot of penalties, a lot of penalty points on the license. At that time, we were banging each other a bit with respect, because in the end we did enjoy and we did laugh straight away after the race, but it was a tough battle. And another one which unfortunately there is not a lot of videos on it, and no onboard from that. It was with Button in 2010 in Valencia, on the street circuit. We did start together, and actually we went through 6-7 corners side by side. Then I lost position to him, and there was Weber in front. And before turn 9, probably, or maybe like something like this, there was a big braking into the very slow corner, which was going on the bridge. So Weber was in front, Button behind, and I was like third of them. So yeah. Weber stayed in the middle. He tried to close the door from Button. So Button overtook him on the outside, and I went into the inside, and I overtook them both in the same time.
That's fantastic.
Yeah, it was like a really nice. Unfortunately, you know, it shows you how technology changed and improved also in Formula 1. Because in current days, you go out from the car, you have all onboards from every driver straight away. In the past, it was very difficult to find onboards. And even if you find, for example, this onboard doesn't exist, or probably it exists in somewhere, but it was never showed. So it was really nice.
If you have the possibility, you can avoid to answer if you feel it's uncomfortable. If you have the possibility to change something in Formula One, like anything on the technical side to make races more appealing, more interesting, considering you have a very long career, so you drove cars in the past and now they are completely different, what in your opinion could be interesting to do?
If I would have one, let's say, joker, and I have to play it, I would definitely reduce the weight of the cars.
Okay.
The reason, I think that there will be more than one advantage, and in different region as well. First of all, the cars will be nicer to drive, more reactive, and they will give you a chance to recover. So there will be less inertia when the car slides. It means that the car will be easier to catch, and it will unlock more aggressive driving. And then also it will help the tires, because the force goes through to the tire from downforce, which the cars are much bigger now, and they are much heavier. So I think the tires are stressed much more than they were 10 years ago. Yeah. And this, you know, it will make the tires' life easier. Which will also unlock possibility to attack them more, to drive more aggressive, and I think it will be the most efficient way of improving the show and also the feeling of the drivers, which is a very common line, because if the drivers are able to attack more, it will be a better show, and once you are able to attack more, there you are always playing in the narrow window of mistakes. You know, in current days, you have to really take care of energy you put into the tires or stress of you put on the tires. You have to really be more thinking. In the past, with lighter cars, you were smashing it, and it was a bit different driving. But I know this is quite impossible because the cars are much bigger. You know, I think a lot of people don't realize how much bigger the cars are. It's incredible. I remember I haven't seen Formula One. So the last time I drove before my accident was 2011. Yeah. And then I drove 2017, 2012 car. And then I went to Hungary for a test. And it was the first time I have seen, let's say, a modern car with my eyes. And I say, whoa, that's big. That's really big.
Yeah, there is a nice question from Maple Tonic. That's is for both, but I would like you to answer. Is have you guys ever thought of doing a rally together?
Well, it means that he knows you have some rally experience. Did you
yeah.
You drove, no? You drove.
Yeah, I did Rally Mexico, I did Rally China.
Yeah. With Rally Group Mexico. N?
Group with N. A Group N. Group with N. A Group
yeah.
N.
Yeah. Yeah, still. I mean, my first experience with Group N was Mitsubishi Evo 6 Group N car.
Okay, mine was Evo 9, so
yeah,
modern.
Again, VIP.
Okay, so you can consider that.
Well, but who will be driving? I don't want to sit on the co-driver.
I knew already.
Co-drivers are mad. It's incredible. I think they have to have really something not connected. In a good way, I think the job from rally point of view, I think many times the co-drivers are underestimated, and there is not enough attention, and the success is also from them, and I think it is a very, very tough job, and yeah, big respect to them.
Yeah, I fully agree, because it's really difficult, and you have to trust them completely, and it's. Yeah. So, did you have an hero when you started your career? A driver that is your example, your idol, your.
Well, I never had. It's a bit funny situation and the story, because in the end, when I was growing up, I was in love with karting.
Yeah.
But I was coming from. I'm coming from Poland, where when I start karting, I was an exotic guy. Mm-hmm. There were only a few drivers before me in previous years that did try to compete on international level. I remember my first race when I came in 98 to Gento, in the south of Italy, Puglia. Many people were not understanding where I'm from. Not Italians, especially some region of Italy, they are not very good with geographic. So for them, all Eastern Europe countries are the same. So Czech Republic, many times they say Czechoslovakia, which is not existing anymore. There is a Czech Republic and the Republic of Slovakia. And Poland, it was somewhere there. The thing has changed a lot. And for example, there are many good young Polish karting drivers, really good ones, which is nice to see. But coming back, I never had one single person. The fact is that all my friends or people who I knew, they were more interested in running. Mm-hmm. But when I was growing up, they were trying to tell me to do rallies, and I was going always opposite. No, I say, no, I'm in love with karting. I don't want to do rallies. But I always remember, I did follow a bit more rallies because they were more available in the television. For example, when I was a kid, I couldn't watch Formula One in television. There was no Formula One in television. So in the end, it was more rally drivers, Carlos Sainz. Not the one who is not his son, who is driving in F1 now. Tommy Mäkinen, those people. I remember Tommy Mäkinen with Evo 6 Group A winning a lot. I remember Carlos Sainz throwing his helmet, on the 1 kilometer to the end of GB Rally, where he was winning the title. The Toyota stopped. So those people, but yeah, in my home, with my idea, I never thought about Formula One. When I was doing karting, I was enjoying, for many, many long time, I really didn't know if I'm good. For example, when I was going first time for Italian race, European race, it was my first not Polish or international race away from Poland. My father always kept me, downgrading, keep it very low profile. Mm-hmm. And And I remember, you know, we were first free practice, all those nice cards with nice helmet. I race white helmet, standard overall, no branding, nothing. On my card, there was only my name, nothing else, no stickers. And I see all these official drivers, nice looking, you know, big teams. We came there with one mechanic. And my father told me there was Erik Janis, who was a Czech guy. And he was very good. And he say, okay, so follow him. And I start following him, you know, I go out behind him. And after three, four laps, I start going faster with him. So then I jump out after the free practice and I say to my partner, oh, it's not too bad. I was faster than him. And he say, no, no, he was not pushing. He was, you know, just bedding in the engine, running in the engine, stuff like this. But the fact was that I did a pole in qualifying. So
he was pushing.
And then I realized that, well, probably I'm better than what I was always told. Because in my head, in my mind, I was hoping to get there and qualify to the final, to top 34. And in the end, I was the fastest guy. Okay, then I finished second, but I was kind of shocked. But it was, for me, it was, you know, poorly driving, you know. I remember those days where really incredible for me because I really enjoyed them and I was only driving and enjoying myself and enjoying my passion.
But to be honest, not because we are friends, but I think you are a real talent. I mean, there are different categories of drivers, the ones that have the speed in their blood and they are talents and they can go fast with any car, with any... you were fast in rallying, you are fast in Formula One, you were fast in karting. So you are a real talent, and I believe that most of the people that are following this this live are sharing the same thought with me. So
thank you.
Congratulations. But it's
no. But what I say is always, and I really think that I never have been so good driver in every other category than I was in karting.
Mm.
I probably it was also because I have grown up very quick mentally. I started living away of my country, away of family when I was 13. Age of 15, I was living alone. You know, I was always with the teams, enjoying time, and I was always very good at that that period with carburation. It was very, very important. In current days, there is a lot of sensors, data, displays, dashes. So karting has moved forward as a technology. In the past, there was a small dash with small letters with RPM numbers. And everything what you were doing, like fine-tuning the carburation, the engine, it was by your ears. And, and it was very, very important. And I have... I did learn very quickly, thanks to my father. There was some hard lessons the way he teach me, but I learned very quickly. And actually, I realized that I won a lot more than I should win. For example, just because I was a bit more sneaky, you know, I don't know how to say, poorly because of speed, I couldn't win, but I won some races which were impossible to win, and I won them because of different things. And
in a clever way.
Yeah, it's in the way that I remember some people were even commenting that some bad comments about me afterwards. That I heard some comments when I left karting that people thought that I was on drugs.
Really?
Incredible. Yeah, I mean karting
so
is special.
Doping.
Yeah, it's like, you know, that I was too focused, too clever sometimes in some ways that for a kid of 13, 14 years, it was not common. But I take it. I really enjoyed those times and yeah.
Okay.
And I grow up a lot.
Look, how are you spending your day in this period? Can you do some training? Do you have the possibility to keep you?
Yeah, I mean, of course, I think we have to, we did. And we have to adapt, all of us, to the new situation. Of course, for a sportsman, for a driver, it's not an easy situation. But in the way, I think we did adapt, all of us. I do quite a lot of cycling, of course, on the trainer. So using the technology. riding with friends on different applications that you can race each other, you can do training together. Finally, I did get a part which I was missing in my simulator, so I do a bit of driving as well. And honestly, last 2 weeks, the days fly away pretty quickly because I keep myself very busy. I had to, let's say, learn a bit of cooking because I'm spending the time alone and I have to also eat sometimes. So, but yeah, I'm not saying that I'm enjoying it, but I'm not panicking, you know. And I think, okay, the situation and the period is a very unique and a very dedicated period.
Yeah.
But staying home, I think we are still lucky that we are actually able to be healthy and stay home. Many people, especially in Italy, they don't have this luck and they struggle much more and the period is much worse, much tougher for them. So all in all, we all hope that sooner or later it will end up and we will be able to slowly, I think, because it will be slow come back to the normality. And for sure, this period, it will be, even when it will be finished, we could remember it for long, not only in my mind, but actually the world and the sport will change. And probably the way we will be living for many, many, many time or long time, it will not be exactly the same as it was 6 weeks ago.
And we can appreciate more what we have, of course.
Well, I think yes, I think, and I hope people will this period will help also to understand that I think we are living in a very, very unique sport, which is Formula One, which is very dynamic, very fast, and very focused. And I think many people forget that there is a life, there is a health, which is even more important. And sometimes I think we forget and we take it for granted that what we are living is a normality. But I think we have to find the right balance. And I think some people will realize that sometimes it's better to spend a bit more time at home or enjoy your life and not be focused only on let's say, job and work. Of course, work is very important because without this, we will not have opportunity to enjoy our life, to have money for living. But also, you know, health, I think, is still something which without health, you cannot do anything.
True. Yeah, true. Robert, I don't want to take too much of your time. Thank you very much for this very nice chat. And keep in touch.
In Italian, it will be easier.
Yes.
Can I use only 30 seconds to say something in Polish?
Yes, of course, okay.
Dziękuję wszystkim za przybycie tutaj do czatu. Coś mnie rozłączyło. Dziękuję wszystkim i miejmy nadzieję, że ten okres ciężki minie. Nie jest łatwo, ale trzymajcie kciuki za ludzi, którzy robią naprawdę dobrą robotę. Zostańcie w domu i do zobaczenia, mam nadzieję, że wkrótce na torach. Cześć.
If you want to say also
Italian.
In Italian, so
okay.
We make everybody happy.
Volevo ringraziare tutti per il supporto e ovviamente in questo difficile periodo non è facile per nessuno, ma veramente bisogna essere uniti, bisogna rimanere a casa, rispettate le nuove regole della vita che abbiamo adesso, perché è molto importante, dobbiamo veramente farlo non solo per noi stessi ma per gli altri, quelli che purtroppo non hanno avuto tanta fortuna. È l'unico modo per sconfiggere questo nostro nemico invisibile, è riunirsi, rimanere a casa e speriamo di rivederci presto, più presto possibile in pista. Vi ringrazio e a presto. Sono stato
perfetto,
bravo. Vai.
Bravissimo. Grazie mille, Roberto.
Ciao, ciao a tutti.
Ciao, grazie a te. Ciao.
Thank you. Bye.